Singapore Revisited. Sir Stamford Raffles returned to Singapore in October 1822 with mixed feelings of pleasure and disappointment. Upon the one hand, his child had thrived more even than he himself anticipated. As early as the end of March 1820, Colonel Farquhar had been able to write, "Nothing can possibly exceed the rising trade and general prosperity of this infant colony. Indeed, to look at our harbor just now, a person would naturally exclaim, 'Surely this cannot be an establishment of only 12 months' standing.' In short, the settlement bids fair to become the emporium of Eastern trade, and in time may surpass even Batavia itself. And assuredly, in the last 2 years, progress had been no less rapid. Upon the other hand, the behavior of the resident himself gave grave cause for dissatisfaction. 'We landed yesterday,' Raffles wrote on October 11th, 'and I have once more established my headquarters in the center of my Malayan friends. The coldest and most disinterested could not quit Bencoolen and land at Singapore without surprise and emotion. What then must have been my feelings after the loss of almost everything that was dear to me on that ill-fated coast, after all the risks and dangers to which this my almost only child had been exposed, to find it grown and advanced beyond all measure, and even my warmest anticipations and expectations in importance, wealth, and interest, in everything that can give it value and permanence? Rob me not of this, my political child, and you may yet see me at home in all my wonted spirits, and with an elasticity about me which will bear me up against all that party spirit can do to depress me." But while the progress of the new settlement was in every way most satisfactory, such progress had been by no means due to the resident. The circumstances in which Colonel Farquhar was first appointed have already been stated. At first, it was generally understood that the appointment was a temporary one, Colonel Farquhar being anxious to return to England. As Singapore grew in importance, the views of its resident altered, and at the end of 1820 he wrote that, "As the same urgent call no longer exists for my proceeding to Europe on furlough, I desire to postpone departure till season of 1821-22. Meanwhile, Raffles had been drawing up a new scheme of administration under which Singapore should be made directly dependent on the government of India, and the salary of the resident reduced. Mr. John Crawford was to succeed Colonel Farquhar in the government. Colonel Farquhar, however, refused to state the time of his departure, and finally, when notified that, as Mr. Crawford was about to leave Bengal, his temporary and dependent appointment must now cease, set Raffles at defiance, and refused to recognize his authority. In this state of things, Raffles had no alternative but to supersede Farquhar and take upon himself provisionally the administration of the settlement. It is true that Raffles was censured by the Supreme Government for taking this step, which nothing but a real and positive necessity could justify, without their previous sanction. But when can a real and positive necessity exist, if not when authority of a superior officer has been openly set at defiance? In their judgment upon the conduct of Farquhar, the Supreme Government wrote in agreement with the views of Raffles. They considered that Farquhar's measures had been unfortunate when they had departed from your instructions. These measures had indeed been such as to justify the indignation of Raffles. If there was one cause Sir Stamford had at heart, it was the suppression of the slave trade, and so far as possible, of slavery. In his efforts on behalf of this cause, he had more than once risked the criticisms and censures of his superiors. He had given no special instructions with regard to the slave trade to Farquhar, because he never could have supposed that a British officer could have tolerated such a practice in a settlement circumstance like Singapore, and formed after the promulgation of the Act of Parliament declaring it felony. I need therefore say," he continues in his reply, dated January 25, 1825, to Colonel Farquhar's memorial, "how much I was shocked in hearing the cries of a female shortly after my landing in Singapore in 1822 proceed from a vessel in the river whose principal cargo was female slaves for the market of Singapore." We have seen the relentless war waged by Raffles and Bencoolen against the gaming and cockfighting establishments. He now found that such had been established at Singapore contrary to the most express and positive orders which Farquhar had received. Raffles had further to complain of irregularity in the construction of public buildings and appropriation of the ground expressly reserved for public purposes, for the benefit of a few favored individuals, whereby the whole plan and order of things directed on the first establishment of the settlement was so far deranged as to render it indispensable that his proceedings should be disavowed, that the town should be removed, and that the whole of the land should be resumed at great expense to government and no less loss to individuals. Sir Stamford's disappointment was great. I had anticipated, he wrote in a dispatch dated January 15, 1823, the satisfaction of constructing all necessary public buildings free of expense to government, and of delivering over charge of the settlement at the end of the present year with an available revenue nearly equal to its expenses, and it is extremely mortifying that the irregularities admitted by the last resident oblige me to forego this arrangement. But if there was this reverse side to the shield, upon the whole, Raffles had good reason for satisfaction. For the first time, he had a free hand for the accomplishment of some, at least, of his ideals. In his local laws and regulations, and especially in the report on the administration of justice, addressed to the supreme government, Sir Stamford anticipated in a remarkable degree the views of later times. I am satisfied, he wrote, that nothing has tended more to the discomfort and constant jarrings which have hitherto occurred in our remote settlements than the policy which has dictated the exclusion of the European merchants from all share, much less credit, in the domestic regulation of the settlement, of which they are frequently its most important members. Some degree of legislative power must necessarily exist in every distant dependency. The laws of the mother country cannot be commensurate with the wants of the dependency. She has wants of which a remote legislature can very imperfectly judge, and which are sometimes too urgent to admit the delay of reference. Circumstances Singapore is, even the Governor General and Council, with whom the legislative power will probably rest, is hardly competent to legislate for such a state without the assistance of local advice. The administration of the settlement is necessarily limited to one individual, who, having no counsel, could not be entrusted with the enactment of laws which require deliberation and advice, and the mode which I have provided seems at once the most congenial to our national institutions, the most simple in its adoption and application, and the most promising in its advantages. At the same time, that neither the supreme government as the higher legislative authority, nor the local resident as the governor and executive officer of the state, loses any of the powers or attributes properly vested in him. The nomination of magistrate is vested in him, and, as the appointment is a mark of respect to the individual, inasmuch as the exclusion is a disgrace, it may be considered as rather extending his patronage and authority than otherwise. Dispatch, June 6, 1823. As amended, the system of government involved the annual selection of 12 magistrates from among the British community. Local laws and regulations were to be enacted by and with the advice of the magistracy. Proposed regulations might originate with the magistrates, and in such cases, in the event of a difference of opinion, and the resident declining to enact the proposed regulation within 3 months, the magistrates may request that their recommendation be transmitted for the consideration of the Governor General in Council. Subordinate to the magistrates, there shall further be appointed one native captain or headman, with one or more lieutenants or assistants, over each principal class of the native inhabitants, who will be invested with a special authority over such class, and held responsible for the general conduct of the same. Upon the question of the laws to be administered, Raffles' remarks are of especial value. The population of Singapore will probably consist of a mixture in various proportions of strangers from all parts of the world, having commercial concerns at the port, though chiefly of Malays and Chinese. And it would be impracticable for any judicial authority to become perfectly acquainted with the laws and customs having the force of laws acknowledged in their own countries, respectively by the varied classes of so mixed a population. And it would be still more so to attempt to administer these in such a manner as to preserve them inviolate, even in the mutual intercourse of those classes severally amongst themselves, much less when justice is to be administered between two persons of different classes. It is, I believe, generally admitted that in colonies formed entirely by Englishmen, they naturally carry the laws of their country with them, subject only to such local modifications as the constitution of the colony may require. But 9/10 of the population of Singapore will most probably consist of Chinese and Malays, and the restrictions of the legislature may for many years operate against any considerable extension in the number of Englishmen. Raffles proceeds to give by actual instances the strange results that would ensue were the criminal law to be administered according to native notions. His general conclusion was to apply the general principles of British law to all, equally and alike, without distinction of tribe or nation, under such modifications only as local circumstances and peculiarities, and a due consideration for the weaknesses and prejudices of the native part of the population, may from time to time suggest. In the language of the proclamation of June 26, 1823, nothing seems to be left but to have recourse to first principles, to use every precaution against the existence and temptation to crime that is found consistent with the perfect liberty of those who have no evil intention. and when these precautions fail, to secure redress to the injured party, if possible, and such punishment as will be most likely to prevent a repetition of the crime either by the party himself offending or by those who may be inclined to follow his example. Nothing should be endured in the settlement, however sanctioned by the local usage of particular tribes who resort to it, that has either a direct effect or a notoriously strong tendency to endanger the safety or liberty of persons, or the security of property. And in the same manner, no want of what are considered legal formalities in any country should debar a person from having substantial justice rendered to him, so that legal and moral obligation may never be sundered. In the same proclamation, it was stated, "The imprisonment of an unfortunate debtor at the pleasure of the creditor seems objectionable in this settlement. The debtor should only be liable to imprisonment in case of fraud. And as far as may be necessary for the security of his person in the event of his not being able to find bail during the process of the court, and for the performance of the decree after judgment may be passed. It is well known that the Malay race are sensibly alive to shame, and that in many instances they would prefer death to ignominy. This is a high and honorable feeling, and ought to be cherished. Let great care be taken to avoid all punishments which are unnecessarily degrading. Let no man be punished without a reason assigned. Let native institutions, so far as regards religious observances, marriage, and inheritance, be respected, when the same may not be inconsistent with justice and humanity, or injurious to the peace and morals of society. Let all men be considered equal in the eye of the law. Let no man be banished the country without trial by his peers or by due course of law. Let no man be deprived of his liberty without a cause, and no man be detained in confinement beyond 48 hours without a right to demand a hearing and trial according to due course of law. Let the public have a voice through the magistracy, by which their sentiments may at all times be freely expressed. When it is remembered that these rules were drawn up for an Oriental dependency 9 years before the first Reform Bill, it will be recognized that Raffles was far in advance of the time in which he lived. In one respect, Singapore did not offer a very suitable field for the working out of Raffles' ideas. He believed that the only principle upon which the future administration of a country could be rendered simple and advantageous, both to the interests of the people and of the East India Company, was that of gradually raising into importance such of the native chiefs as from rank and character might be entrusted with authority, but no native could ever superintend the multifarious needs of a polyglot commercial station such as Singapore. What Raffles could do by associating the Sultan and the Tumenggung with the resident in the administration of the criminal law, he did. But beyond this, it was impossible to go. The methods which had been suitable enough in Java and Sumatra were wholly inapplicable to the case of a single city like Singapore. Here again, however, time has justified the wisdom of Raffles' general principles, and the government of the Malay Federated States, as it exists today, represents exactly the ideal to which Raffles was pointing. In one important respect, Raffles was able to realize his hopes, and the port of Singapore became a free port, the trade thereof open to ships and vessels of every nation, free of duty, equally and alike to all.